stained glass window, and I can tell you that those words of that 23rd Psalm that we said have incredible power. Maybe as much power as anything in our sacred scripture, as any words that are out there. I've been there by bedsides of folks who, as they are leaving this earth, are comforted by hearing those words that there is a shepherd that is leading them. Then on the other side of the grave, as we stay here in confidence that our beloved is taken care of, has been led through the valley of darkness to a place prepared just for them, we take incredible solace at that too. It's a powerful image. It's an image that allows us to connect to words that can be sometimes a bit too abstract. And so it's an image that marks us and works on us and continues to have power and meaning in our lives. But it's an image of something that I have no experience with. I have never, ever in my life met a shepherd. Even in Buckeye County, I have never met a shepherd. Now, some of you are going to come after and say, well, I was a shepherd sometime. But I do know a little bit about what being a shepherd was in that particular time. And also, though, the beautiful thing about that image is a shepherd was lowly. And the incarnation is about God coming in a vulnerable, naked child into this world dependent on us. And the image of a shepherd is not of a mighty king. And it ties us to that ruddy young boy, David, who connects to God through the imagery of what he does for his sheep. And it connects to the first people to hear the story of that new birth, the shepherds. And it connects us to a tangible way to understand God's love and care for us. But in that first century, a shepherd had a tireless job, slept in the field, and there was generally a pen. It wasn't a closed-in pen. It was usually a stone pen and about 3.5 sides, and it was left open. And if you're the first shepherd to get your sheep there, good for you. You got to have your sheep sleep in the pen, and you would sleep across it, across the opening. And if any animals or any thieves came by, you would be there to be able to defend your flock. So the image of that one sheep disappearing and the shepherd leaving the 99 is sort of like the Mad Hatter of shepherds. He would lose his, he may be a wonderful shepherd to all of us, but he would lose his job day one. But that's how ridiculous God's love is for us, and that's one of the things that we're supposed to be able to connect to that. And the people that heard some of these stories in the first century, they had that image of the shepherd lying across the gate opening. They had the ridiculous image of a shepherd letting 99 wander aimlessly while they sought out the one. But the one problem I have with the image of Jesus as the good shepherd is that it kind of lets us off the hook. We get to be sheep who eat grass and wander away sometimes. Not the pettiest of animals. But I love the way that we do this story this particular year in the lectionary, because it ties the story of the Good Shepherd to two other very important readings. The first one from Acts, Peter is going into a new place, and he comes across a beggar who's asking for money, and he says, I can't help you, buddy, with that, but I can do something for you. And he heals him in the name of Christ, and he gets up, and he's healed. And if Peter left it at that, he probably wouldn't have gotten arrested, but then he attached a sermon to it, which is when he started to get into trouble. Again, and there's a pattern to this. He continues to get into trouble. So he is arrested, and he's defending himself in front of Caiaphas and the other chief priests by saying that he's healing the sick in the name of Christ, who came and healed the outcast, the lepers, the blind, the deaf. And how could he be punished for that? And then we have the other image, the letter from John, of what it is to be a Christian, what it is to be a follower of the shepherd who lays down his life for the sheep. And he says, you also ought to be able to lay down your life for one another. You need to be able to love like Christ loves, so that love, that body of Christ, can embody in you, can abide, can set up residence inside you. So we're not off the hook. We have a wonderful image of a God that loves us unendingly. But we also have a responsibility to represent Christ to the world, to embody that love, to lay down our lives, whether the world away. What does it look like in our lives in Fauquier County? Well, there are two stories I'd like to share, and one I came across in the last couple days. It's about a woman in Minneapolis who lives next to a very unusual resident for her to be living next. You see, in 1993, this woman lost her son. Her son was taken from her. Her son was murdered. Her son was 20 years old and was murdered by an acquaintance, a 16-year-old, because of a fight that that escalated, and the 16-year-old shot his friend or his acquaintance in the head and killed him. And at first, this Mary Johnson wanted the full extent of the law to be placed upon this young man. She sought justice, and the hardest justice that could be delivered. And in the process of seeking justice, she felt like something was rotting inside. She started to realize that she needed to forgive, and she goes to the prison, and she works with the person who did this to her son to reconcile, to get to the other side of forgiveness, and then eventually advocates for it. Fast forward 22 years, and their next door neighbors. She spends her time going and helping parents whose children have been murdered or killed, helping them cope, helping them get past the anger and the hurt. He spends his time in prisons and in churches, telling people about the power of forgiveness, the gift of reconciliation, and how transformative that can be, both in the ability to forgive themselves and the ability to be forgiven and to forgive others. What that can mean for one's life. Next door neighbors. That woman laid down her life, or at least every possible instinct in her life, to be able to be something countercultural. Be able to live into that letter of John. And lives have been transformed. This other story came from Thursday morning. Bishop Gulick was talking a few months ago about an employee situation. When he was first elected bishop of the Diocese of Kentucky, he inherited the staff that was already there, and you size up your staff that you've inherited, and he said he was particularly unimpressed with one member of the staff. Wasn't quite sure what his predecessor had seen in this particular staff member. She was always sort of unkempt. Her desk was a mess, much like mine. She was heavyset and just seemed to sort of always be scattered and not quite on task. Didn't seem to have that success model that her world seems to be stacked upon. And she, for the life of him, couldn't figure out what gifts she brought to the table. Said something happened that allowed him to see her in an entirely different light. He learned her story. Turned out that she had been happily married for a long time, or at least married for a long time, had raised children, and then at one point in time, her husband came to her and said, "I'm in love with somebody else. I'm leaving you." And he left her for another man. And she was devastated, as anybody would be. Absolutely devastated. A few years later, she discovered that her ex-husband and her husband's partner had contracted AIDS and were dying and had no place else to go. And she took in both of them. She took in her ex-husband and her ex-husband's partner and cared for them until their dying day. She understood what sacrificial love was. She understood the kind of shepherd that would leave the 99 and go after the one. And when we get away from this model of job qualifications, Ted was able to see somebody uniquely qualified to represent Christ to the world, to help the diocese and the larger church represent Christ to the world. We are so fortunate to have a good shepherd. To have someone that loves us enough to leave everything. Loves us enough that we can't escape that love. We also have a responsibility to represent that love, that relentless pursuit to the world. The care